Hello everyone, and welcome to week 13, data visualizations. So why do we need to visualize our data? In general, people do better with pictures. And even when we're talking about databases and really complex data, we are saving our data and we want to access our data, but we also want to be able to share our data with others. And so we have to find ways of being able to share the data so that other people will be able to follow the conclusions that we've come to and understand the reports that we've created and the results of the queries, or even how well the query was working. Generally, lists and numbers don't mean a lot to people. So if you just hand them a big list of, 1,000 numbers, that doesn't really mean that much. But if we could hand them a picture showing them sort of where those numbers are and what those numbers mean, it's a lot easier to sort of get people on board with what we're talking about. Databases are collections of data, so any of the data visualization options can be used for the databases, for the data in the databases, or the performance of the databases. We'll be talking about reports more next week, but reports are really commonly used to be able to share information from our databases with other people. So we had talked previously about documentation, and that's how our database is put together, how we want to go about using it, adding to it, changing it. Whereas a report is after our database is together, let's share some of this information with others. Analytics and business intelligence are actually really common when we talk about databases, and they will use a lot of visuals to be able to get a better understanding of the data and database to other people. We can use visualizations to show database relationships and how schemas work. So one of the things that you hopefully remember from schemas is it was a way of visualizing the relationship between the tables when we were talking about SQL-based databases. We can also use visualizations to show portions of the data or the query results, or we can use it to show database performance. So that's like how quickly the query worked, how much effort the query took, stuff like that is also a really good use of visualization. So it's not just I've asked the database, how many customers have we shipped to in the last week. I'm also saying how long did the query take to ask the database how many customers we shipped to in the last week. There's a whole bunch of different types of visualizations. You're probably really familiar with charts, maps, and graphs. Those are some of the most common visualizations that you will have seen for data. You may remember this from the Intro to Data course. And that's one of the ways that we can sort of show numbers. One of the things that you start getting to more when you hit industry is widgets and dashboards. Dashboards we will be talking about more next week in reporting, but widgets and dashboards are a way of being able to monitor the performance of the database or particular pieces of data in the database. We can do automatic visualizations or manual visualizations. So when we talk about data visualizations, we can have ones that we make. We could make a chart or a graph or something. How many customers have we shipped to in the last week? But we could also say, hey, database program, can you please make a chart that's this and update it? Or, hey, database program, maybe it's one of the ones that has AI embedded. What data do you want to show? Can you show me a chart that's all three of these points? Okay, well, this isn't really working. How about, a graph? AI-based visualizations are getting to be more common, where you're sort of asking the database, hey, what's the most commonly used thing and can you show it to me? So it's kind of a little bit more hands-off, and it's using AI to make those guesses and say, fill in the rest of the information. So normally when we create a visualization, we want to pick the data that we are visualizing, and then we want to ask about the scale that we're talking about. So let's say, for example, we're talking about the amount of customers that we've shipped to in the last week. Well, then it would probably make sense to figure out what kind of scale we're talking about for customers. Are we talking about 10, 100, 1,000, a million? And then we can pick that as one of the axes of our graph. And then we can do the time as another axis for the graph. Now, this could be, you know, maybe a line graph. So we could have, oh, look, it looks like our shipping has gone up. Maybe it's the holidays. Or we could do some variety of like bar chart. Oh, look, this one's bigger than the other ones. Maybe it's because people say, oh, Monday afternoon, I'm depressed. I'm going to go shopping. You know, whatever that happens to be. But AI would be able to sometimes help with that and make some of those choices and decisions for you. However, I would like to say that I have the exact same warning about AI that I had when we talked about AI previously, which is that AI still has issues. There are still ethical problems. Now, AI is getting used for a lot of art and visualizations. If we are talking about AI and art specifically, that's like kind of a whole other can of worms. It's actually a huge problem. But if we're just talking about AI and visualizations, there isn't quite as much, I suppose, stealing going on. But the caveats and warnings are still there. Just because AI says, I think you should want this, does not mean AI is right. Just because AI says, I think this is a reasonable graph, does not mean that it is a reasonable graph. You have to actually go and sort of give it a gut check. Does this actually make sense? Does this actually show what I want it to show? Does this actually function the way that I want it to function? Will this illustrate what I want it to illustrate? So that is something to just be wary of. Now, some examples of charts and graphs. Charts are the overall term that a lot of people use for visuals. Charts are used to show large amounts of data, and then you can see patterns. All graphs are charts. Not all charts are graphs. Graphs are usually used to show raw trends over time. Line graphs and bar graphs are two really common options. So, for example, you know, we can look at how often "eh" is said by Canadians versus Americans making fun of the "eh" thing in Canada. We could look at this pie chart, the use of time 15 for a 15-page essay due in 12 hours. And we can see how much time is, say, spent making the margins really small, making a cover page, skimming your research notes, and how much time is spent crying and on social media. So you can see these are different ways of being able to illustrate this. You know, or for example, cats versus dogs, how much they miss you when you're gone. Cats don't care. Dogs, after about 30 seconds will be like, oh my gosh, you've left me forever. I'm so sad. This is the greatest tragedy of my entire life. And I'm so glad you're back. But you can actually see all these. I would also like to have a note. Yes, I do have a chart on here that is the number of breweries in the U.S. correlated with the solar power generated in Peru. I would like to make a quick note that if you follow that link, that's actually spurious correlations. Correlation is not necessarily causation. To read more about that, you can go to the link, but just correlation is not causation, just so that you know. Okay. Example, dashboards and widgets. So dashboards are one of the ways that we can visualize what's going on. Widgets are the thing that makes up the dashboard. Each widget is designed to show some piece of information. These are the different visuals that we could have. Widgets should be key metrics. So when I say key metrics, I mean, this is the thing that is actually important. Sometimes what you'll see happen is people will put widgets on a dashboard because it's easy to track, not because it has value. And you want to make sure that if you are taking up precious real estate, that it has actual value. Widgets can have different refresh rates. So one of the things that makes widgets different than some of the other visualizations that we've seen is you can actually have them refresh based on more current data. So you could have them refresh every 10 minutes, hour, day, week, month, whatever. And so you can actually have the most up-to-date information in your widget. So like sometimes people use widgets for performance and they'll do things like, you know, see, is the server still running? Is the database still there? What's the current RAM usage on my database? What's the current hard disk space taken on my database? What's the ratio of database to free hard disk space? Things like that. Now, how to tell if it's a good visualization? So there's a couple of different ways we can do this. One of the ways that we can look at good visualizations is there's actually a very well-known person in data visualization called Edward Tufte. I talked about this person in the intro to data class, and they had a list of ways to be able to tell if it's a good visualization. Feel free to go back and review that if you don't remember it. Other ways that we can look at: scalability. How well this visualization works with larger amounts of data. So does my visualization still work if I'm adding in more data? How readable is this visualization? One of the things that you'll notice with a lot of visualizations is sometimes it can be really hard to tell what's going on. You know, maybe there's just too many numbers being shown. Maybe there's just too many categories. Maybe it's trying to illustrate too many things. Maybe the visualization that was chosen is actually not the best way to represent that data. Those are all things that can be a problem. For a good visualization, you want it to be able to sort of communicate the thing that you're trying to illustrate quickly. You don't want to have to sort of look at it and try to puzzle out what's going on. Usability. Is this data something that we need? And does this illustrate it? So is this actually like a useful visualization? It can be really easy to sort of be like, well, I like pictures, so I'm going to add in more. Yay. While tempting, is not actually useful, because then you just end up with clutter and people will be like, okay, well, I don't really know what you're saying. I don't really understand what's going on here. I'm not really following, whatever that happens to be. Interactivity. Sometimes you have visualizations that you can change on the fly. Sometimes they're static. Is that appropriate for the data that we are talking about? You know, if we're talking about the performance of a query, then maybe we just need to have like a static visualization. This is the time it took for the query to perform. But if we're talking about something like, you know, RAM usage, a static visualization is probably not going to be the most helpful unless you're talking about RAM usage over time. Something that's a little bit more interactive might be better. One of the really well-known sites for visualization is called Information is Beautiful. I've linked to that later here and in the on my website. And one of the things that they'll do is they will have some static visualizations and infographics, but they'll also have some interactive ones. So they'll hide some of the information until you click on it, hover over it, they'll allow you to reorganize it. So, you know, you can actually look at the information in different ways. Maybe you want to look at the last 6 months, the last year. You know, maybe you want to look at only companies that have revenue over $1 million. You know, maybe you want to look at treatments that have at least 10, you know, well-done research papers, like whatever that happens to be. And so you can actually interact with those data visualizations. Aesthetics. How pretty is it? The aesthetic of the visualization may not seem important, but it actually really can be, because if you have colors that muddy together, or if you have text that's really hard to read, if you have a visualization where it's really hard to pick out the different pieces, then that's probably not a good visualization. You know, if you have, let's say, a hot pink background with a green, shades of green pie chart and neon green text. Like, that's really not going to be a good visualization. It's not very pretty. It doesn't go together well. And it's going to be hard to read. You know, not anybody, most people aren't going to be able to pick out the text or distinguish between the colors of green. Okay, lastly, accessibility. So a good visualization should be accessible. Accessibility with visualizations is tough but important. There's a wide variety of things that can keep something inaccessible to others. And remember, visualizations are so that we can show other people our information in a way that they understand it. So you want to ask yourself about your visualization. To whom is it accessible? Under what conditions? And for what tasks? It may not be possible to make your visualization perfectly accessible to every single person at every time, but what can you do to make it better? And what can you do to offer other options? So here's an example of a good visualization. This is actually from Information is Beautiful. This is one of their static visualizations, which is why I'm showing it. And so this is the most common four-digit PIN numbers. And you can see that they did this where the two axes are the first two digits and the second two digits. And then you can see that they actually did some color coding to show what's more common and least common. And then you can see the ones that are using their birthday in the day-day, month-month, or month-month, day-day formats and how popular that is. You can also see where people are using their birth year and how popular that is compared to some of the other options that are very not popular. And you can see some of the most common and least common PIN numbers. On a side note, if your PIN number is one of the most common PIN numbers, seriously consider changing it. If your PIN number is like 1234 or 0000, like, it's the same combination as your luggage. Just don't do it, please. And if you don't get the reference, I guess go watch Spaceballs. You're welcome. Okay, what makes a bad visualization? Visualizations that mislead the viewer. So sometimes people will mislead on purpose and sometimes they'll do it by accident. If you have visualizations that are misleading on purpose, like that's just not nice. But if you're doing it by accident, just think about like, is this illustrating what I wanted it to? Hiding relevant data or inaccurately representing the data. One of the things a lot of people will do is change the scale and proportion, trying to sort of show something that isn't correct, or sort of try to guide you towards something. Whereas if you look closer at the visualization, you'd be like, wait a minute, this doesn't make sense. You can also see sometimes people will use too much data in their visualization. So they'll try to kind of be like, oh, look how well thought out this is. Oh, look how much effort I've put into my visualization. But really, they're actually just trying to hide things that they either didn't know what they were doing or they didn't understand the data or the data is showing something that they don't want you to see. Unfortunately, it is not uncommon for people to manipulate the visuals for the data to try to guide you to see things that are not true. Using the right data, but in confusing ways, is another really common issue where people are trying to be like, oh, look, the sales have jumped up. But really, there's like a, 10% increase, and the 10% increase is in, the end of November, where it's holiday sales. And like, of course, everybody's holiday sales go up because a lot of people do holiday gifts. Like, really? Lack of context. It makes a visualization not good. So if you don't have context, labels, sort of anything on the visualization to be able to figure out like what it's actually saying, that will also make for a bad visualization. You know, it's really important that you think about what are the minimum labels that you need. Are you adding extraneous information? And how can you sort of clean this up? Examples of bad visualizations. Let's look at serial killers by country. Now, if we look at this visualization, we might think that the U.S. is having a problem with serial killers. Now, while that may or may not be the case, one of the things that you're not seeing is population. So while it is true that, say, Poland has less serial killers than the U.S., there's also way less people. So because we're not looking at the sort of ratio of serial killers to non-serial killers, we're just looking at straight out numbers, it's a problem because, you know, the US has over 300 million people in the population and the UK has 65 million people. So yes, of course, they are going to have fewer serial killers. Another example of a bad visualization. Number of US Americans with ancestry from every European country. What are we looking at? Genuinely, what are we looking at? What are the colors for? Why are some the same? What exactly do those numbers mean? These are all important questions that this visualization does not answer. So these are some examples of bad ones. Okay. Now I'm going to talk about averages and percentiles. One of the things that comes up in industry a lot is some surprising issues when we're talking about data visualization. And averages and percentiles are one of those surprising issues. You may not have heard of this or seen this before, but this is actually a super common problem. So visualizations can be misrepresentations are willfully misleading. So let's say, for example, we have an average salary of 2,000 euros. Let's say that's good. You might think if as long as you're making around 2,000 euros, average salary, you know, you need, you know, I don't know, 1,900 euros to be able to do well in this country. Yay, average salary is 2,000. People are doing great. But if you look at the numbers, 9 out of 10 people make 1,000 euros and one person makes 10,000 euros. So the average salary is 2,000, but 9 out of 10 people live way below the poverty line and one person is living it up like a king. So that's not actually great and is a real misrepresentation of the affluency of the area. Let's look at another example. Let's say we're looking at response time. So let's say we're talking about help desk tickets. Tickets come in and we want to see how quickly these tickets are getting serviced. Well, if we look at the average, it'll actually make it seem faster than it really is. The median makes it seem closer to reasonable, but it doesn't necessarily take into account everything. So if we look at the average response time number of requests, we can see that these, the percentiles, the averages, and the median are actually really different numbers. And we can see that the response time is going to be different, and this can actually make a really big difference to what we're talking about and how quickly these requests are happening, how quickly they're getting serviced, and how long it's taking for somebody to get to them. Another thing this doesn't show is if we're talking about this in terms of queries, not help desk tickets, failed queries can fail really quickly. So if we run a query and it takes a really long time, that might actually be a good thing because it means it's actually running. Whereas if we take a query, we screw up the query, and it comes back and it goes failed, that might happen in fractions of a second. So then we can be like, oh, our response time is great. All of our queries are running at fractions of a second. You know, not paying attention to the fact, yeah, they are because they've all failed. Okay, percentiles. So we hopefully remember from our math classes that averages are just a way to be able to see what the average number is. It does not take into account anything in terms of where most of those numbers fall. Percentiles can sometimes show more accurate information because they will include how much of the data is actually represented. So if we look at this normalized graph, we can see that this normal distribution is showing that most of the responses for whatever this happens to be happens in the middle. And if we look at the 50th percentile, the graph on the left, we can see that half are in one side and half are in the other. So this means that this normal distribution is also in the sort of right range for percentiles. However, if we continue to have this normal distribution, but we look at something called the 10th percentile, we mean that 10% of the data is less than the value and 90% is greater than or equal to the value. To calculate the 10th percentile, let's say we have 10,000 values. we take all of the values and order them from smallest to largest. We identify the 1001th value where 1000 or 10% of values are below it, and that will be our 10th percentile. So that's how we can figure out where the percentile actually is, what that means. So we're actually looking at not just how is the data distributed, but how much of the data is represented. Now, the reason this will become important. Let's say we are looking at this graph where we're looking at the frequency and the response time. We can see that we have a median, an average, and a 90th percentile. Okay, if the average is going to not take into account sort of how many things are above and below it, we can have things that will skew the average. So the upper graph is showing the median, the average, and the 90th percentile with a long tail response time. The lower graph is actually showing the same thing, but there's a small bump on the line after the average, but before the 90th percentile. So remember, the 90th percentile is where we are able to see where all of our numbers of data. So, 90% of our customers are looking at whatever. The increase in response time for this small 10% of users wouldn't have been accurately reported if we had only looked at median and average. Because we can see that the average is not that different between the two graphs, we might not necessarily pick up that there was that bump in the tail. But being able to see that bump in the tail by looking at that 90th percentile, we're able to figure out actually 10% of our customers are having this problem with this bump in the response time. So we need to figure out what's going on before this bump starts moving, before more of our customers have problems. Having this insight allows us to be able to figure out, a problem might be coming. We need to go fix it. We don't want 10% of our customers to turn in tickets because we're having problems with, let's say, database access. We want to catch it early. Companies don't like tickets. They don't like long wait times. They like to predict issues and fix them before the customers see them. Okay, data visualizations and accessibility. Data visualizations can be really tough to make accessible. There can be color issues, color contrast issues, lack of alt text. One of the things that you'll notice in all of my PowerPoints is I actually have alt text for all of my images. But some of the images are really hard to make alt text for. Like if you look at the image, then you look at the alt text, like it works, but it's not necessarily amazing because there isn't always a great way to describe it quickly in alt text. Accessibility should be baked into what you're doing. Wherever possible, you should try to make it accessible because you want to be able to share all of your information and data with the most amount of people possible. You shouldn't have to wait for somebody to say, hey, actually, I have a really hard time seeing low contrast. Could you please make it more contrast? You should just have your text be high contrast so that everybody can see it without any problems. You don't want to have to make people ask. Keeping your visualization simple can help. It's easier to describe and it's easier to offer alternatives for. Being mindful of your color and contrast is helpful for the text and the images. If somebody is colorblind, will your visualization still convey your meaning? If not, can you change it so that it does? So are the colors that you're using actually helpful or not helpful? What if you couldn't see the colors? Could you make it better? Think about offering different formats. So if you make a visualization, then maybe you could also make a little, sound clip describing it. Maybe you could make some alt text describing it and offering those different formats so that it's more accessible to more people is helpful. You know, there's a lot of times where accessibility is actually used by people who may not necessarily even realize they need it. You know, for example, closed captioning on videos or scripts for videos. Maybe you listen to these videos and you're like, actually, I really like when she reads the slides because then I don't have to worry about reading the slides and processing them. Oh, I really like that there's closed captioning on these videos because I like to listen to them on mute. I like that there's closed captioning because I listen to them picture in picture and I don't want the voice in the background. Oh, I have them on closed captioning because I have trouble hearing. And, I have closed captioning because I have trouble processing. Like all of these different scenarios, closed captioning can help, or scripts can help, things like that, subtitles. So just think about what the options are. Some examples of tools for visualization. You can actually use AI, ChatGPT, try them out. There are some diagram services where you can go online. A lot of the database tools will actually have business analytics to go with it. A lot of them are built in. And we'll be talking about reporting and dashboards next week. So that's the end of data visualizations, and I hope you're all having a lovely day.